and welcome back to biology. In today's lesson, we are moving into the great wide world of chordates, more specifically, fish. All of the animals we are going to be studying for the rest of this unit fall under kingdom Animalia, phylum Chordata. Now you might be asking yourself, what are chordates? Well, that's a great question. Most people equate chordates and vertebrates, but in fact, they are slightly different. Chordates is a more general term, so vertebrates are a specific type of chordate, and there are a small number, about 1,300 species of animals that are chordates and also invertebrates. This number is extremely small when you remember that there are millions of species of animals in the world. But before we get started with our study of chordates, vertebrates, and fishes, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to discuss the difference between chordates and vertebrates, define the characteristics of the three classes of fishes, identify the main anatomical features of a fish. Let's spend a few minutes defining chordates and vertebrates before we hop into our fish lesson. Chordates have four main anatomical features that define them. A nerve cord, which runs along the back of the animal and develops into the central nervous system. A notochord, a long flexible rod made of a substance similar to cartilage that provides skeletal support. A postanal tail, sometimes only present during the embryonic stage, like humans. For fish, this tail helps their swimming, and in terrestrial animals, it helps animals with their balance. Finally, a pharyngeal pouch. This is what develops into the gills in fish. In humans, like the tail, it is only present during the embryonic stage. What about vertebrates? Like we discussed a few minutes ago, there are invertebrate chordates, like tunicates and lancelets. However, most chordates also fall under the category of vertebrates. Okay, I want you to try something for me. If you are able to, sit up straight and bend forward just a little. Reach behind you and feel the middle of your back. Do you feel those bumps that run up and down your back along the spine? If you would prefer, you can also have someone else bend over so you can see the bumps that run up and down their back. Those bumps are individual vertebrae alternating with cartilage discs that surround your nerve cord. Humans are able to bend down and touch our toes because the vertebrae are a stack of individual bones instead of one long fused backbone. This backbone, along with an endoskeleton of bone or cartilage and a skull to protect the brain, are the main features that identify a vertebrate. What does all of this have to do with our lesson today on fish? Well, I'm glad you asked. We are going to start with fish for two reasons. They are the oldest known vertebrates. Scientists have found fossils of fish dating back over 525 million years. Fish are the most diverse and evolutionarily successful group of vertebrates. In fact, fishes make up approximately half of all vertebrate species, and scientists are discovering new species all of the time. It is believed that we have only identified approximately one-third of the fish species that live in the Amazon River. In this lesson, we are going to discuss what makes fishes unique, their anatomy, and some cool adaptations that have evolved to help them survive. Let's start by addressing the elephant in the room. If you have noticed, I have been using the word fishes instead of fish throughout this lesson. Traditionally, we use the word fish for all plural versions of the word. However, in biology, there is a difference. If you are talking about the plural of a single type of fish, for example, a school of salmon swimming up a river, then you use the plural word fish. But If you are talking about multiple species of fish, for example, a fish tank in an aquarium that has 5 different fish species, then you could use the regular plural fish or the plural word fishes. They are interchangeable, so you don't have to worry too much about it. But it is kind of fun to say fishes. It has a nice ring to it. I think it's time we start defining the key anatomical characteristics of fish. First and most importantly, they are vertebrates. Second, they are ectothermic. Do you remember what that means? It means they can control their own body temperature. Sometimes you may hear it referred to as warm-blooded. Another key characteristic is the evolution of jaws and paired fins. Third in our list of anatomical features are the gills. Fish use gills to breathe via a closed circulatory system. Finally, fish reproduce via sexual reproduction. Most species use a technique called spawning, in which the female releases a lot of eggs into the water and males fertilize the eggs. Some species don't care for their eggs and young, while others do. When talking about the key characteristics of fish, I mentioned the presence of fins and gills. Let's take a moment to discuss these anatomical features in more detail. First up, fins. While the fins look different on all species, they work to steer, balance, and move the fish. There are 4 types of fins: dorsal fins, which help with stability, pelvic and anal fins that also help support stability, pectoral fins, which help steer the fish left and right, and the caudal fin that propel the fish forward. Finally, let's discuss gills. In the most simple terms, fish use gills to breathe. Water flows over the gills, absorbing oxygen and releasing carbon dioxide. These gills are a part of a closed circulatory system, meaning the blood never enters the body cavities but stays within the blood vessels. More specifically, fish have a single-loop circulatory system, which means the blood only flows through the heart once. Humans have a closed circulatory system also, but for humans, it is a double loop, so blood flows through the heart twice. All fish fit into one of 3 categories: jawless fish, jawed cartilage fish, and bony fish. Jawless fish are the oldest known vertebrates. There are only 2 species in this category: lampreys and hagfish. These fish have a simple anatomy of a sucker-like mouth with rows of teeth, a long eel-like body, no fins, and skin made of cartilage. Our next category, jawed cartilage fish, is made up of sharks, rays, and skates. These animals have anatomical features that help them survive as some of the most powerful predators in the ocean. Let's start with their body shapes. These animals have either streamlined bodies that allow them to be fast swimmers or flattened bodies that help them glide. Do you know that sharks can swim up to 60 miles per hour? The next important part of their anatomy is where this group gets its name. They have a cartilage skeleton. Cartilage is a tough, flexible tissue, and this type of skeleton makes the animals lighter and more buoyant, which is important because they must keep moving in order to breathe. If sharks, skates, etc. stop moving, oxygen stops flowing over their gills, and they can no longer breathe. Finally, these animals' powerful, movable jaws make them some of the most feared predators in the ocean. There are, however, a few exceptions. Whale sharks and basking sharks, for example, are filter feeders. The last category of fish is bony fish. This category makes up about 95% of all species of fishes. Like their name indicates, they have a skeleton made of bone, including a portion over the gills to protect them. They have flat scales that are also made of bones, and unlike jawed cartilage fish, they do not have to swim to breathe because they are able to move their gills to force water to flow over them. One important adaptation present in bony fish is a swim bladder, or an air-filled sac that helps the fish control their depth in the water without having to expend energy by using their muscles. How do they do it? It's really cool, actually. The fish controls how much oxygen gas is in the bladder by transferring oxygen between the swim bladder and the blood. More oxygen in the swim bladder moves them closer to the surface of the water, and less oxygen in the swim bladder moves the fish down deeper into the water. Interestingly enough, some deep water fish have oil instead of air in the swim bladder, and some bottom dwellers don't have a swim bladder at all because they never need to rise up in depth. In this lesson, we learned about the three main categories of fishes and how their unique anatomies help them survive in their aquatic environments. In the lesson PDF, we are going to look at the swim bladder of bony fish in more detail, as well as how rising levels of carbon dioxide are affecting shark populations. Our next lesson will move us from the oceans to the skies as we study birds. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time. Hey.